15 minutes of the presentation, and then we'll leave at 5 p.m. for a end. Just about 3 minutes of questions. Alright, so we talked about the Esports Science Officer here at Ulster GAA for the last year or so. I've been studying Esports for 3 or 4 years. I've been involved with the Netball Nation for 3 years, 2 European Championships, Commonwealth Games, and just recently their World Cup and Liverpool. And they're in their highest score ranking of 8th in the world. I'm also SSC coach for the mountain there for the last 3 years, at Nemout. They've 2 Anthem Championships and 2 leagues, and as well as that, I'm just really over the base there for the Irish tournament as well. So that's my kind of background. I've been to teams over the last maybe 3 or 4 years, because up until that point, with my playing career, it was just playing for club, playing for community, right full time next week, just really limited time to go to. Whereas now you can get a few different free time when the retirement comes, they can give you a back. So here's the goal. What's the goal for your players? Use coaches. What's the main goal for your players as a coach? You want to be matched up, okay, so you want to maximize performance, get them ready for the end of the year. And then you can eventually lose my victory. My victory as a coach, S&C coach for Mary. You want to make sure that your players minimize injuries as much as possible. By your type of training, you're doing the right plan, your training, that make sure that they're getting the right thing, the right time, and it's not too much too soon. Also talked about there is improving game performance. So, those what you do in training, transfer across the pitch. How are you doing in your training? Is it going to make any better players? And hopefully that will be something we'll touch on later on. Needs analysis. Can you tell me what physical qualities are required to play in this tournament? Maybe football. Physical qualities, yes, mate.
Flexibility.
Speed. Speed is big one. Strength is a big one, yeah, lots of different types of strength, which we'll touch on as well. Agility, that would be, touch on agility too. Stamina, yeah, so energy system development, as I call it. Right, so what kind of energy system are you developing? Are you developing perfectly? Are you developing anaerobically? And what's more appropriate for you? So, yeah, just to touch on various strength difficulties. Various fitness qualities. Within that area, you've got lots of different bench strength. It's just about benching, how long you bench for, how long you squat for, how many reps, how many sets, what's the load. So, primarily pre-season, we'll do a lot of strength and just strength endurance work, and then towards max strength work. So, these here are reps of 8s, 10s, 12s, 15s, 20s. And then to max strength work in season, then we'll work on maybe 3s and 5s. Explosive strength. Anybody moving in terms of explosive strength? Olympic lifts, yeah, so we'll be doing Olympic lifting when we're in the stage of the year. Player isn't confident doing any types of Olympic lifting. Generally, what you're thinking about is we're trying to jump with weight. So, any other types of exercise you can do, jumping with weight. Probably a more reactive strength for the players. Jump of weights, if I have a player who just cannot get the technique or hasn't got a training age that are developed up to that point, where they know the skill, we'll get them to be able to do a back squat for the jump, or if they're still not comfortable doing that, we'll get them to either the trap bar deadlift, or they're in that position there, and they jump into weight. So they get the same, just get the same idea of it, they're jumping into weight. But it's moving up as technical as an Olympic lift, so to speak. And then in season now, you see how many graphics I'm working with now, you think they're in service, because they're jumping, they're winding, they're doing all these sorts of silly things that you might think, but it's reactive strength work that we're primarily working on, jumping on heights, rebounding up onto another height, and that'll be really 3 or 4 times. And again, transferable across into on the pitch, because we're able to jump higher, we're able to swim faster, all the tendons and all the nice and strong, and again, back into the defensive, we're able to go robust. So those are the strengths I work on for the season, and these are the traits of the qualities for the season, right? So do it. And I don't know, what do you think of the game consists of most? So anaerobic is being able to explosively take off, run for a certain length of time, recover, and then do the same again. Whereas aerobically, you're doing a low level intensity, you're doing for a longer period of time. Right, so pre-season we'll do a bit of this, but in season we'll probably do more of that. And then as we get closer to game, in season, chance of time will work a lot and speed as well, along with the high-end dynamics. So we talked just about here about the strength qualities that work on. Max strength. So we look at big movements, like our squats, our deadlifts, our push and pull, and the movement quality. Alright, so that's in season. Pre-season. Explosive strength, minimum end of leg, chance of time is what we're going to work on. Again, jumping with weights. Finally, coming at this stage, we're doing a lot of jumping and landing qualities, so rebounds, jumping over hurdles, jumping off blocks and off hurdles, getting reactive as much as possible so it relates to how high is the jumping and landing. The top of strength qualities, think of on the pitch, maybe do a lot of your conditioning work. So aerobic fitness is what we'll do pre-season. We'll do runs and drills and small set of games where the duration will be 3 minutes plus, 3 to 5 minutes. All players will be working at full intensity if we can, but obviously you can only work at your max for 30-40 seconds until the energy starts to drop, and that's where the aerobic system kicks in. Alright, so after that, then the final fellows are working aerobic. If they're all doing what they should be doing at that time, small set of games, nobody's bluffing, but they're working aerobically. It's a very low intensity to get that level. And the work to rest ratio, so it's 1 to 0.5. So if I'm doing a 3 minute drill, we're only getting 1.5 off. And the test we do for that, I don't normally do it, but if we have pre-season, it'll be a 3 kilometer time trial, and you can judge that by a step of ice at 100 minutes. Right, so that's a rumor, mainly gone pre-season, but we'll do top up sessions in the season. Your development of that there will last a lot longer than this. Okay, so we'll do one session of that a month to keep aerobic levels topped up. And do that because that will help this system here to recover a lot quicker. If you're aerobically developed, that will help the anaerobic fitness recovery levels a lot quicker, so you can do more sprints more often. So the duration of anaerobic work is 30 seconds to 90 at the very most. Moderate high intensity, obviously you see from this here, work rest is a lot different from aerobic. If you're here working 1 to 0.5, you work from here 1 to 1 to 1 to 3, so 30 seconds, you might 90 seconds off. And the test we do for that will be the Euro. We don't want to do the test. Someone's us. You don't do all the big test. Yep, so when you do the big test, it's a 20 meter back and forward to the pendulum line and just get faster. The Euro test is a 20 meter sprint. You take off, turn 20, come back, then you've got a 5 meter walk there and back, and you get time to reset yourself and you go again. It's a lot higher intensity, it's a lot faster, but it's more related to our game. Okay, so if you're doing that, there's resources online where you can download the 1K test. And I'll do your test in about 10 days. So I'll just give you an idea of our strength session pre and in season, what we do. So our session in season, we do lots of squats, lots of lunges, and lots of hinges, so hinging at the hip. And that will be a low body session. Alright? That will be on one night, we'll do those three. And on another night, maybe your push pull exercises. But you can be very big on posterior chain. We all simply know what posterior chain is. If you remember Ali back in the day, we were supplying the posterior. Right, so you're big on all of the big muscles of the posterior chain, the back, your calves, your hamstrings, your glutes, your back, your shoulders. Okay, we don't leave out the front. but our main emphasis was on these muscles. Why? Right, we focus a lot on sight. Four, you think about the movements you do, jumping off the ball. The main movements make our muscle groups contract, glutes, hamstrings, back. So that's why you do all that. Sprinting, same thing happens, not testing the tip off. The hamstrings and the glutes contract. Those are the main muscle groups that we focus on to get the best possible outcome. Those internal movements there. In season then, those are the big ones we do, but these are also some of the assisted stuff we do. So after we've done Scotland Hinge, we'll move on to intensive prevention exercises. So the smaller muscle groups, we're looking at their movement patterns, are they able to squat and lunge and push and pull or whatever it is in that correct technique. And again, it'll be all tailored at that stage because somebody might have a recurrent injury on an hamstring or a hip. So then we'll do a lot of injury prevention stuff at the end of that session, focusing on that. So pre-season, we'll look at a lot of high volume, so lots of reps, 10s, 12s, 13s, 20s. In season then, we'll reduce that down to 3s and 5s, mostly. And another chance at time, maybe we can do 1s to 3s, maybe doing a 1 rep max on a squat, or 1 rep max on a hang clean. And just get them as explosive as possible. So that's our strength session, what it looks like. This is our conditioning session, pre-season and season. So pre-season we'll do a lot of aerobic development, right? We'll build a good base for a couple of months. Then as we come towards the league, in terms of time, we'll focus on that more manner. The effects of this year will last a lot longer. You will have the same effect of an aerobic session, maybe even up to 3 to 4 weeks after. Whereas an anaerobic session, you will lose the effect of that maybe 1 to 2 weeks after that. Right? So this will last a lot longer than this, which is why we continually have to keep on top of that in season, but we'll maybe do one of those every month or every couple of months. And all the while, we're looking at lung technique and efficiency. I think that is a big number of ones to hear, because you can fix a lot of problems earlier in the season. You can see lung technique, which is very poor. You think of one player, just in particular, we always lift their knee across the back of their calf, and the knee won't come to the rear. So this development was, when you're doing this, you focus on high knee, knee underneath the knee. Right, so that's the focus for him, that's his coaching cues. As a result, we became a better, more efficient runner. We had more energy then. We was obviously able to conserve that energy for his games. He was able to play better. So it just all had a snowball effect. Just to make him a better athlete all around. So this is what one of our conditioning sessions may look like. We'll warm up for 10 or 15 minutes. We'll do a lot of pulse raising. We'll do linear running. We'll do lateral running. We'll do multi-directional running. Dynamic stretching, mobilize joints. We'll do activation and then we'll do performance. So this phase, you're still in warm-up, but it's related to what we're going to do. So if we're going to play a championship game, well then the performance phase, you're doing a small set of game and you're building intensity. So maybe say about 20 seconds here, 50%, get out of the water. You're going 75% another game. You know, so you're building towards max pace. If it's a speed session, we'll do some max sprints to get us up to the level you need to sprint. Okay, so then we'll go into your conditioning and development. 10 to 15 minutes. Why are you just putting here? And on the end. Alright. You want to be fresh, that was one thing to get around. We went and done a warm up session, and then the main manager coach says, oh, I need the first 10 to 15 minutes here, and we're going to do some work with them. And right. And then they go and do all these tightening builds and they're out to the gas that they came into. And you're just thinking, there's no point in me working the speed now because they're wrecked. You're not going to be up to a top speed environment where they're going to rest. So that's why if you're developing speed or agility, whatever it is, try and keep it start, the freshest. And it's roughly about 10 to 15 minutes. Move on to a bit of skill work. 10 minutes, and then the majority of the session is comprised of a small set of game or your full set of game. Right, and that would be a typical session for 5 minutes. All in, that takes about an hour and a half. And one of the main things we use coaches, if you're developing that type of session, you need to do what? Neither are you. There's no point in you coming to think, like, pick up a piece of paper and what we did next. You need to get three or four books, is there? Like, you're going here, you're going here, you're going here, and you'll be on ball and everything joins you. Right? So everybody's organized, knows what they're doing. We have a timetable set up, but each coach knows what they're doing, it's a specific thing, and how long they're doing for. So just get your data from an order, make sure you know what they're doing at the right time. Free come, organized, ready to go, there to respond to that whatever step they're doing. So over the last week, we've been developing some sort of database that we have for teams. So we've got two games early in the league, two games in the mid-league, two games at the end of the league, and then another four or five chances games. Right, so we took an average of every player, played 60 minutes, waiting to play 50 minutes, and then we hit. We just listed the early bad players' data. So we've just taken an average of every player that played the full game, and now we've got a nice database of metrics of players are coming in different positions. So as you can see, total distance here, fullbacks cover the least distance at just over 6k, whereas midfielders just short of 7k. So that's a full kilometre of different in 60 minutes. Alright. So as you can see, there's a difference in total distance covered in the game in comparison to the different positions. Can you see? Fair enough. So that's nice to see that you can see that there's a difference between different players and different positions. Does it lead to the question we need to train the players differently? What do you think? You probably will to a certain extent, yeah. But if you go on the next slide, you can see sprint distance is different to game. Midfielders before cover a lot of distance, whereas in comparison to maybe half forwards, half backs, they're probably less sprint distance. And then you need to see that full backs and full forwards are not even really on a par with midfielders. So these guys are covering a lot of distance. These boys here can really cover as much sprint distance. So when I'm doing a session, warm-up, I need to get everybody together to do the conditioning development, because I know the sprint distance they're covering is very related to what they're going to be getting in the game, if that makes sense. Alright, so that's just an idea of sprint distance then for these positions. Top end speed, so how fast do you go? Again, the full forwards, the half forwards, even full backs get a higher speed than say in the field, right? Yeah, so you think a cornerback has to really do all things, and next thing the corner forward makes a run, you have to get the top speed to try and chase that. Why would the midfielder not get that same sort of speed? He's moving more often, that's a big one. He's covering a lot more ground than a fullback. So if he's on the move and he's doing a lot of running, well then his energy is going to be set. He's not going to have enough energy to score. Whereas this boy, he's maybe sitting here ready to go, you know, for maybe 20, 30 seconds and then climbs away. So he's ready to go, maybe more so than this guy here who's doing a lot of traveling. This is one thing to look at, and it's nice to see in terms of this is power plays, and this is directly related to the GPS unit. Picks up movements, turns, agilities, sprints, decelerations, accelerations, and it gives you a total score at the end to say, well, this is how it involves you working today. So again, you can see midfielders tend to be doing a lot more just in turning, accelerating, decelerating. But you know, it's not as much of a change or a difference as a comparison to the total distance. And then that directly relates across to player load. Alright, so you can see here, player load is calculated by a lot of those different things, but also tells me as a coach how much I need for my players to recover. So we've got on the graph, who would you say that needs to recover in minutes? Midfielders, and there's lots of pattern between people playing midfield and people that need to recover most of it. So there might be an instance then that midfielder who comes to you on Tuesday night after doing this game on Sunday, right, you're doing the skills, you're doing the warm-up, you're doing a bit of shooting stuff at the end, but you're staying out of main conditions, right, which is just a bit more fatigue than everybody else. Right, so it's managing it there to make sure that you stay in the pitch that wee bit longer, injury prevention as much as possible. This is another week of feedback from the coaches in terms of your assessment of coaching. So this is a full forward here. You can see in the first half, we spent a lot of time around base and D, making these runs. Second half, and we drift a little bit more. That would be for the coach who insights you, but you could do in the first half, but you go out in the second half. We need you in around this area here where the danger zone is going to be, right? That's in comparison to what we're doing normally here. You might be running back tracking with my man, so that's all around good. But you want your danger man up here as much as possible. Again, this is a half forward. Again, you can relate it for him to see where he was in the pitch. You can see the difference in the short runs here as in comparison to longer runs as the half forward, and then that relates back to the sprint distance. So, we talk about there is a big one, and that's one where coaches can say the difference is that you need to recover more slow than another player. This is something that you can take away to your players. It's something that I've helped set up. It's a tracking system for your players, monitoring those, right? So you can set up, anybody heard of Google Docs, right? So you set up a thing online, Google Docs is a form, you send a link out to your players, they click on the link, and it's a pre-made questionnaire to give them up to 4 or 5 questions. All the questions will be, what session did you do? How hard did you find the session? 1 to 10. How many minutes did you do it for? And you can leave one at the very end. Any injuries to report, right? And that'll come back to you, or your first people, or your manager, or whoever it is. And this will pop up. This will not pop up in an Excel form. It's on your phone. I have this color-coded. So, say, for instance, a player in a game, and it was 10 out of 10 to give it, multiplied by 60 minutes. Well, then that's 600 training units that would have for that session. And I got highlighted that anything over 600 comes into a red zone. So that's when we need to say this player is high-end, trained, or played a game, and he really needs to cover it to watch that. So you can get feedback on that straight away. And it's good for dual clubs. It's good for players who are involved in different sports and different teams. If you use a player, or a coach, or a manager, whoever it is, and keep tabs. You're just on the welfare of the players, you're trying to make sure that they are on the pitch as much as possible. And it's just making a little bit of feedback you can get and make an intervention if needed. Right? So if you see a player, another back to one player and one ticker, they had a crucial injury, they played a game on Saturday, sorry, Sunday. They played a soccer game on Saturday. They trained football on Friday, during hurling on Thursday, football on Wednesday, hurling on Tuesday. So there was 5 or 6 days in the road he was out, and something had to do, and it was me, right? I'm not saying that would have prevented it altogether, but again, if we had known that data before that, if he was input the data, he would have been able to make a call once about 5 days ago here, leaving out of the game that we won, and maybe that wouldn't have happened. But again, it's believable for you, the coaches, to make a nice bit of call on that. So this is a typical in-season session. 10-15 minutes of warm-up, pulse laser, light skills, 10 minutes stretch and activation, 10-12 minutes we do speed agility work, 10 metric for the ability of presses. And the skills block will be 89%. Small set of game for 20 minutes, and then finishing off with a full set of game, or some sort of game play, or tactics, or whatever, that's the work of the session. And again, that will be a typical training week. So Monday, recovery, upper body strength. So if we've been here here on Sunday, we're doing something here, whether it's active recovery, whether it's rest. Tuesday then, on the pitch is your big conditioning block, your main leg, your big leg that you're going to get the most out of, training hard, FMC, lower body, strength work on Wednesday or off. And then these nights are the same, but they're interchangeable. So if you want the night off on Wednesday, train on Thursday, vice versa. Again, not all of these athletes. Fellas there who are married for 4 games, you know, need to spend time at home, and that's just a bit of flexibility in the training week. Then Friday night, you'll be on the pitch again, a bit of skill work, a bit of match play, shorten down intensity, getting ready then for the game Sunday, and that's what we're talking about in the training week.